Isn't that so wonderful? That's how we all come, is just as we are. Christ accepts us. It is not we have to clean ourselves up. It's not we have to get ourselves right before we're accepted by God and washed by Him. It's that He takes us as we are and transforms us. He doesn't let us stay as we are, but He transforms us into the image of Christ. When I was a kid, my siblings and I attended a small Christian school in Philadelphia. It went from preschool up through sixth grade and only had about 120 students in the whole system. We didn't have a cafeteria to serve lunches out of, but there was a small kitchen attached to the lunchroom slash gymnasium slash chapel hall slash playhouse slash whatever else the room needed to be. And every Friday, my mom and a group of other mothers would get together and they would cook a hot lunch for any of the students that ordered it. If I was lucky, it'd be my favorite pork roll, grilled pork roll on a bun with cheese and ketchup on top. Really, kids will eat anything if it has ketchup on it. Sometimes it's ranch, honey mustard, but you put a sauce on it, they'll eat it. Usually there was one specific lady of the bunch that went and did the shopping, but occasionally she would be unable to do the shopping for that week, so my mom would take care of it. She would fill in, go shopping. And those were some of the greatest shopping trips of my seven-year-old life. We would go to the super exclusive, extra secret, admittance to pass holders only shopping realm of Sam's Club. What a wonderland of shopping to behold for a seven-year-old. They had jars of pickles bigger than my head. They had free samples for free. They even had, and I always marveled at this, they had a trampoline turned upside down and hanging from the ceiling. I don't know how you were supposed to jump on it like that, but I knew one day I would save up enough money and buy that. Fortunately, I realized just how dangerous those are as I grew up. But the coolest part about those shopping trips was the little plastic card that you had to show them to get in. I felt like such a big shot. Oh, we're allowed in. We got to go in while all those other losers shopping at those other loser stores couldn't. I would sometimes even lag behind my mom a little bit as she entered the store so that she could flash the card, and I could then knowingly, as a seven-year-old, nod my head to the checkpoint man and say, I'm with her. Sam's Club was a big deal for a seven-year-old. Well, time passed and I became an adult. I won't say grew up because that means giving in. And for the roughly the past 18 years, Kathy and I have owned a Sam's Club membership. Somehow the magic has kind of worn off a little bit. Sure, you can still get a jar of pickles bigger than my head. Yes, they often still have free samples. But now when we go and fill up a cart, I have to pay for it. That stings. But the thing that hasn't changed about shopping at Sam's Club is that feeling I get when I walk through the door and show the checkpoint man that, yes, I have the right to shop here. I have the magic plastic card that gives me full access to the super exclusive, extra secret, admittance to pass holders only shopping realm of Sam's Club. And as much fun as it is to look at a shopping trip at Sam's Club through the eyes of a seven-year-old, today we're going to look at an even more important, even more exclusive access that we have in Christ. That is access not to a store, but to heaven and to God Himself. In verse 5, Thomas says, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one, get that, no one comes to the Father except through me, but by me. If you had known me, you should have known my Father also. And from henceforth you know him and have seen him." In this passage, verses 1 to 14, we're looking at our relationship with Christ, a relationship with Christ, what that looks like. We saw first there's reassurance in Jesus, the reassurance of Jesus. We saw in verse 1 there's reassurance in the face of unknown difficulty. Whatever we face, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. We saw assurance of the Father's ultimate dwelling. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. That's our third point under there, the assurance of the faithful's unquestionable deliverance. He's preparing a place for us. I go to prepare a place for you, verse 3, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And D, under the assurance of Jesus, we saw the assurance of the full, unwavering direction. Verse 4, and whither I go, you know, and the way you know. And Thomas, in hearing this, he says, well, hold on, Jesus. What are you talking about? We don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way to where you're going? So we saw our second point, the requirement of Jesus. We saw first the request of Thomas, saying, what's going on, Jesus? Why can't you just tell us plainly, what's the way to get to the Father's house? We saw Jesus' response, the response of Jesus in verse 6. He says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Jesus is the way to God. Jesus is the truth about God. Jesus is the life of God. So today we're going to look at the requirement of Jesus. The requirement of Jesus. Verse 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. It's exclusive. You have to have that Sam's card to get in. And here's the crux of the matter. Jesus is the unique expression of the Godhead. He is the second person of the Trinity. One person, fully God and fully man. So to look at these, we're going to actually take your outline and kind of go backwards through it. We're going to look at point 3 first, and then point 2, then point 1. So point 3 is Jesus is the only life of God. Jesus is the only life of God. So we have to ask then, well, what is life? Well, John 8:12 says, then spake Jesus again, said unto him, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. John 1:4, in John's prologue to this book, he says, in him, in the Word, in Jesus Christ, was life. And the life was the light of men. It's the joy that we have in life. In fact, Thayer's Greek lexicon defines the Greek word used here in John 14:6 as it's zoe, Z-O-E, as life, real and genuine, a life active and vigorous, devoted to God. It's not just, well, I have life as I lie in my bed all day long and do nothing. It's active, it's vigorous, it's genuine, it's devoted to God. That is the life that he is talking about. When you hear a baby's laugh, see the smile of a dear loved one, watch the tenderness with which a groom treats his bride, understand the sacrifice of a mother for her children, observe a couple spend the entirety of their lives together until the long end. That's the life we're speaking of. It is the life that God gives us, active, vigorous, genuine. So how long is this life that Jesus is talking about? Is it just for 70, 80, 90 years and then it's over? Well, John 3:16, you could probably quote with me, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. John 3:36, and he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not on the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. Romans 6:23, For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So how long do we, or how do we have everlasting life? It's by believing in him. This is not some temporary life. This is eternal life. As I was considering that this week, I couldn't help remembering, growing up as I did in the 80s and 90s, I've played my fair share of video games. One of the challenging things about most video games is that you only have a limited number of lives with which to beat the game. And in general, the older the game, the harsher it was about the consequences. When you die, that's it. You start over from the beginning. There was no save point. In fact, Stephen was playing an old video game on the an old NES, Nintendo Entertainment System, on the Switch yesterday, RC Pro-Am. And I heard him playing it. I recognized the sounds. I was like, I know that game. And he said, yeah, it's RC Pro-Am. And he said, it's really hard. I said, yeah, you know why? He said, because it's old. It was back from a time when you actually had to have skill. You had to put time and effort into learning the controls of the game. I got to think about one of the great classics of the arcade and the NES system was Contra by Konami. This is where two commandos, Bill and Lance, bet you never knew their names. They have last names as well, but I forgot to look those up. Bill and Lance fight their way through seven stages of an enemy installation, only to realize in the most 80s way possible, it was aliens all along. And you have to then destroy them. It's a frenzy of enemies, bullets, bottomless pits, and somersaults. And you have to make it all through this with only three lives, which to the inexperienced usually wouldn't last you past the first stage. But there was a way around this limitation. It was the code. There is what is known as the Konami Code. It's been enshrined in our culture. Many of you would probably, I could ask you now and you would know what it is. It's up, up, down, down, left, right, A, B, A. And if you were playing with your sibling, it was select start because you had to go to the two-player and then hit start. And if you entered this into the game of Contra, as the beginning title was scrolling, you would not start with only three lives, but you would start with 30 lives. Man, after playing for hours with only three lives, barely making it through the first stage, to have 10 times that, it felt limitless. You could run through that game for hours and not lose all your lives, although we still struggled to make it out of the first stage. But for a young boy, this felt like the greatest cheat code of ultimate power. You went from a limited, boring three lives and it's over. You had to put another quarter in the machine, or you had to wait for your brother to die so you could start over again, and you had to fight the exact same guys because you were in the first stage. You went to 30 lives, near limitless. In fact, if you had the game genie, you could put in a code where you would never die. You could just run through bullets. It was pretty amazing. But you know what's even better than 30 lives in a nearly 40-year-old video game? Eternal life in Christ. Never ending, never failing life in and with Jesus. He says, I am the life. So is this life for just the here and now? Do we get to experience this life of Jesus just for the 40, 50, 60, 80 years of our life, and then it's over? Well, not at all. John 11, 25 to 26, Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. He's saying, look, even if you die, even if you come to the end of Contra and you have wasted your three lives, you're back again. I am the resurrection. When we come to the end of this life, that is not all there is. The materialists try to claim, well, life is only about the physicality. It's only what we can see and feel and touch. And they completely throw out the spiritual. Because life is more than just the here and now. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. Verse 26, and whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. He poses the question to Martha. He says, believest thou this? Jesus is not just the life for here and now, but is the life forever. There is therefore no fear in death for the Christian, because he is the resurrection. He is the life that will sustain us throughout all eternity. And that's comforting. We've had a lot of deaths in our family this past month, this past year. There are even some in our fellowship who are this day watching their loved ones slip towards heaven. The comfort and hope that we have is that Jesus Christ is the only life of God. He upholds us and he sustains us. So, what's the quality of this life then? Is it just, well, it's going to be a life of pain and suffering, that's about it. You might as well get used to sorrow and misery because that's all this life is. Sure, there is a lot of that in there, but John 10:10, Jesus says, the thief cometh not but to steal and to kill and destroy. He says, I have come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. He gives us that abundant life. It's not just that little tiny bit. When I was a kid, what am I talking about? Now, my favorite drink is apple juice. I love it. It's so sweet. I'm pretty sure when the Greek authors were writing about the nectar of the gods, I'm pretty sure they were describing apple juice. But I remember growing up, and my mom would get out the little tiny cups and pour me just a little bit, and then would have the nerve to water it down with water, and come on, Mom! I don't want a little tiny sip of watered down apple juice. I want the gallon in my hand so I can just pour it all over me so that it just gets in me. It's so good. That's the abundant life. We don't have just a little teaspoon of life in us. And we, well, I gotta be careful with it. It's the only one I have, and it's so-so, but it's mine, okay. No, we have abundant life in Christ. We have his life in us. 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. This is how John starts his letter. He says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. He's talking about Christ. He's talking about the eternal word, the second person of the Trinity. Let me read that again. Which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, which we have handled with our hands of the word of life. Verse 2, for the life was manifested, and we have seen it and bear witness and show it unto you, that eternal life which was with the Father was manifested unto us. That's the life that we have. The eternal, immortal, never-ending life of God in us. It's not just the cheap prize they give out for all participation awards. This is the precious, valuable, matchless life of Christ in us because he is the life. The quality of this life is the very life of Christ, the full manifestation of the life of God, an abundant life dedicated to full obedience to God the Father. This obedience gives us full satisfaction and joy. In fact, John Piper is famously quoted as saying, God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. Meaning that I most experience the abundant life now when I'm looking for my satisfaction not in the things of this world, but in Christ. When I look to God and only God and am satisfied in him, that's when I raise my hands most and say, God, you are amazing and glorious, and I can most glorify him. Jesus is the only source of abundant resurrection, eternal life, because he is the life. So let's look secondly then at Jesus is the only truth of God. The requirement of Jesus, he's the only life, he's the only truth. Since Jesus alone holds the life of God, then his life reveals the truth about God. Truth is exclusive. It is right, and everything else is wrong. Truth cannot contradict itself. It cannot make a false statement, otherwise it would not be the truth. Truth is dogmatic. That is, it follows a set of rules no matter what. Oftentimes, dogmatism is seen as a negative, narrow-minded way of viewing the world and living in it, but J. Vernon McGee expresses it this way. He says, I had a teacher who was the most dogmatic, narrow-minded person I have ever met. She insisted that 2 + 2 = 4. It didn't make any difference what you had two of, apples or cows or dollars. She always insisted that 2 + 2 = 4. She was dogmatic. She wouldn't have it any other way. I have found that the bank I do business with operates on the same principle. Only in my case, it's 2 - 2 = 4. And they are dogmatic about it. Friend, he says, let me say to you that one of the characteristics of truth is its dogmatism. It says, this is the truth. There is nothing else that is true. It is only this. McGee goes on and is very careful to explain. He says, we can't reverse that and say all dogmatism is truth, but truth is dogmatic. Jesus is the truth because he reveals the Father. He speaks, acts, and shows who the Father is, how he behaves, and who he is. D.A. Carson puts it this way. He says, Jesus is the truth because he embodies the supreme revelation of God. He himself narrates God in John 1:18, says and does exclusively what the Father gives him to say and do, John 5:19 and 8:29. Indeed, he is properly called God, John 1:1, 1:18 and 20:28. Jesus Christ, he is God's gracious self-disclosure, his word made flesh. That's who the truth is. Jesus is the only truth about God because he alone has seen the Father. He alone reveals the Father, John 1:18. No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten of the Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, has declared him, John 6:46. Not that any man has seen the Father, save he which is of God. He hath seen the Father, and because he's seen him, he can then declare him to us. He shows us what the Father is like. He is the truth of God. And when he speaks, it is the truth and only the truth. So we see first that Jesus is the only way to God. Since he alone holds life and he alone reveals the truth, the truth about life that he reveals is the way to the Father. D.A. Carson again puts it this way. Jesus is the way to God precisely because he is the truth of God and the life of God. Because he holds those two things, because he is those things, the truth and the life, he therefore is the way to God and the only way. Jesus declares that declares the truth that he alone is the door of the sheep. Everyone who claims otherwise are thieves and robbers. Only by entering through him will people be saved. We see this in John chapter 10. Glenn, you can put the first point up there. Thank you. John 10, verses 7 to 9. Then said Jesus unto them again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. Verse 8, all that ever came before me are thieves and robbers. But the sheep did not hear them. Verse 9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. He is the only door. We talked last week about the wide path to destruction and the narrow gate to life. He is the door to that narrow gate. It's only through Christ that we find salvation. It's only through Christ that we find the truth about God. It's only through Christ that we find life in God. Amen. Everything else leads to death. When Peter, when brought before the high priest, declared that life was found only in Jesus. In Acts 4:12, says, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby you must be saved." It is through Christ and Christ alone. That's it, because it's exclusive. What this boils down to is something that every religious person understands, even if they don't verbalize it. That is, the way to God is blocked. Something needs to happen for them to get to God, to make it to heaven. So they perform good works. They sell magazines. They live a life watching out for karma. They give to charity, perform penances, focus on doing better in the next life. They even kill themselves as martyrs to try to make it to God. In the Old Testament, this hindrance in reaching God was pictured in the veil in the tabernacle and the temple. It separated the holy place from the Holy of Holies, where God was. The veil was a visible symbol for what really separated man from God, and that is their sin. The veil stated that you could not come into the Holy of Holies. You were barred. The only one person could come in, and that was a priest. And he could only do it one day a year after purifying themselves first. This priest was what the people needed in the Old Testament, a mediator, a go-between, someone to carry their needs on their behalf to the one who can meet those needs. But God showed a better way. In 1 Timothy 2:5, there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. When Jesus died on the cross, the veil was torn from top to bottom, showing that the way to God had come at last. The ultimate mediator between God and man is the way, the only way to God. Thus, he can make the claim, "No man comes to the Father but by me." F.F. Bruce puts it this way: He, Jesus, is, in fact, the only way by which men and women may come to the Father. There is no other way. If this seems offensively exclusive, let it be borne in mind that the one who makes this claim is the incarnate Word, the revealer of the Father. The one who makes this is not just somebody saying, "Well, you know, I think there's only one way." No, the one who makes it is the truth about God, the life of God. He can make this claim and have it hold up. If God has no avenue of communication with man apart from his Word, mankind has no avenue of approach to God apart from that same Word who became flesh and dwelt among us in order to supply such an avenue of approach. Jesus Christ is the bridge. He is the one who spans the gap between mankind and God. And he alone is the way to the Father. Let's look quickly then at D, the revealing of the Father. The revealing of the Father, verse 7. "If ye had known me, ye should have known the Father, my Father also. And from henceforth ye know him and have seen him." This statement in verse 7 might seem, well, a little out of place. But remember, Jesus is responding to Thomas's question, verse 5, saying, "Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way?" Thomas puts it kind of bluntly. We don't know where you're going, something about the Father's house or something like that, many mansions, many rooms. But we don't know where that is, so how can you expect us to know how to get there? So Jesus explains it again. He says, "If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. In fact, you do know me. You've spent 3 years with me. Therefore, you do know my Father as well." in Christ, we not only have access to the Father because he is the way, the truth, and life, but we can know and see him, for Christ has revealed him to us. God is not some far-off God, some impersonal being that wants nothing to do with us. He created us. He loves us. And he desires to have a relationship with us so much that he sent his Son to show us his life, to reveal his truth, to be his way, so we might come home to our loving Father, the one whom the Word reveals, the one we can know by knowing the Son, because they are the same. They are God. What an amazing God we have. The one who loves us so much. He could have left us alone, could have left us to die in our sins and be perfectly just in that. But his love compelled him. He said, they're going to find a way on their own. They're going to try to find a way on their own. And every time they try some other way, they are going to fail and end up in hell, facing my judgment, my wrath for all of eternity. So he said, Son, I want you to make a way. I don't want you just to make a way, though. I want you to be the way, the only way. I want you to show them my truth, the only truth. And I want you to reveal to them my life, the only abundant life possible. Aren't you thankful for a loving God? Aren't you thankful that we have the way, the truth, and the life? Why then do we hold on to it? Why then do we keep it locked inside, say, no, it's mine, you can't have it? We need to get it out. We need to go out into a lost, hurting, and broken world that is dying and share the truth. Share our life. Show them the way, the only way to the Father. Let's stand for a word of prayer. Father, I thank you that we have the only way, that our searching is over. We don't have to do penance. We don't have to pay fees. We don't have to live a good life to earn salvation, because we have found it, the only way in Christ. So, Father, I pray that we'd be committed to that way, that we would hold fast to that truth, that we would experience that life of Christ, and that we would reach out to a lost world around us and share it with them as someone shared it with us. May we set aside the sins and concerns and cares of this world so we can pursue that way more abundantly, more effectively, and reach the lost. If there's someone here, Lord, who needs to come and set aside that sin, may they do that. If there's someone who needs to come and unite with this fellowship and this church, may they do that. If there's someone who needs to just simply come and find the way, the only way to you through Christ, may they do that this morning. Bless us as we close in prayer. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. As we sing, the altar is open.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, is now.
Aren't you so thankful that Christ wore the crown of thorns, amen, words, for you? Amen. He shed his blood for you that you might have the way, the truth, and the life, amen, with you. Let's go out and share that with the world. Marty, would you dismiss us in prayer?
Lord, we thank you that you are the way, you are the truth, and you are the life. And Lord, thank you that you have given us access to the Father through Jesus Christ. And so we just praise you. Thank you for this time we've had together today. And Lord, I pray that as we go out, we would be your light in the darkened world. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.